Beste aanwezigen, heel hartelijk welkom op de 40ste editie van de Van der Leeuw-lezing. En wat is het een plezier om na inmiddels 3 jaar weer echt een volle kerk te zien. Fantastisch. Dank u wel dat u hier allemaal bent. Al 40 jaar brengt deze Van der Leeuw-lezing schrijvers, denkers, kunstenaars en politici uit de hele wereld naar Groningen. Al 40 jaar levert dat indrukwekkende lezingen op. Lezingen die ons wereldbeeld hebben laten kantelen, zoals die eerste lezing van Barbara Tuchman, die ze vanaf de kansel toen nog heeft uitgesproken. Lezingen die ons op een andere manier naar onszelf hebben laten kijken of naar het leven. Zoals die hele vroege lezingen van Iris Murdoch en van Leszek Kolakowski. Lezingen die ons wakker schudden. Lezingen die ons op een andere manier naar het verleden of juist naar de toekomst hebben laten kijken. Zoals de lezing van David van Rijbroek in 2017. Lezingen die ons hebben laten fantaseren en onze verbeelding prikkelden. Zoals Stefan Hertmans afgelopen jaar en zeker ook het co-referaat van Emma Lesuie. Lezingen zoals die van Isabel Allende in 2001 of Angie Krog in 2006, die letterlijk de tranen over de wangen van mensen hier lieten rollen. Maar zeker ook vurige lezingen, zoals die van Ben Okri in 1997. Kortom, 40 jaar Van der Leeuw-lezing lijkt veel op 40 jaar huwelijk. Dat 40-jarig jubileum, dat vieren we vandaag. Het robijnenhuwelijk, zou ik bijna zeggen. Het robijnenjubileum. De robijn, die bloedrode steen die ongeveer 5000 jaar geleden voor het eerst werd gevonden in wat nu Myanmar heet, heet in het Sanskriet Ratnaraj. En stond in de oud-Indische cultuur voor de hevigste emoties van het leven. De robijn staat voor liefde, voor razernij, voor passie en voor woede. Kortom, de ingrediënten voor een goed huwelijk. Ik vermoed dat de sprekers van vandaag de lezing recht zullen doen aan die vurigheid van dat robijnenjubileum. Ik wil de sprekers dan ook heel hartelijk welkom heten. Filosoof Susan Nijman, schrijver en documentairemaker Johan Frets en filosoof Alicja Kaczynska. Wij zijn zeer vereerd en heel trots dat jullie vandaag inhoud willen geven aan deze bijzondere editie. Maar voordat ik jullie verder introduceer, wil ik graag een aantal mensen met name welkom heten. Allereerst de familie Van der Leeuw, die hier ook vandaag weer met een aantal leden aanwezig is. De Van der Leeuw Stichting is ongelooflijk dankbaar met jullie niet aflatende en oprechte aandacht voor deze lezing. Heel hartelijk welkom. Ook een heel warm welkom voor burgemeester Koen Schuiling en de commissaris van de koningin, René Paas. Deze lezing zou namelijk niet mogelijk zijn zonder... Ik maak een fout, of niet? Pardon. Kom eens, wat zei ik? Pardon, dat is mijn feministische insteek. Het spijt me zeer. Ja, ik vind dat het genderneutrale begrip koningin zou moeten zijn. Kortom, de lezing zou niet mogelijk zijn zonder de steun van de stad en de provincie Groningen. En dat geldt ook voor de Rijksuniversiteit Groningen, de Hanze Hogeschool, het UMCG, de Volkskrant, Boekhandel van de Velde, Stichting Martinikerk, Studium Generale en uiteraard de vele, vele donateurs van onze stichting die vandaag gelukkig weer allemaal in grote getale in de zaal zitten. Veel dank voor jullie jarenlange steun. En uiteraard zijn wij als stichting ook zeer dankbaar aan het congresbureau van Jitte Jaarsma, die ook dit jaar weer garant stond voor een zeer zorgvuldige organisatie en een prettige, gezellige samenwerking. Veel dank ook aan organist Niels-Jan van der Hoek, die u zojuist hoorde toen u binnenkwam lopen, en aan Bano voor de techniek en het klokkenluidersgilde. Nog een paar praktische mededelingen. Net als vorig jaar zal de lezing worden gestreamd en is na afloop vanaf volgende week ook terug te zien op het YouTube-kanaal van de Universiteit Groningen. Kunt u het op uw gemak allemaal nog een keer nakijken. En dit jaar is er ook, meende ik, een cameraploeg aanwezig. Zij zullen alleen de sprekers filmen. Zoals u in het programmaboekje kunt zien, zal eerst Susan Nijman spreken. Na haar lezing is er een pauze van ongeveer een half uur. En omdat wij een vol programma hebben, wil ik u allemaal vragen om ook echt na dat half uur weer op uw stoel te zitten. Dan na de pauze een kort muzikaal intermezzo van studenten van het Prins Klaus Conservatorium. En daarna volgen de co-referaten van Johan Frets en Alicia Gesinska. En dan na afloop, rond 7:10, zullen de sprekers signeren. Er is een stand van Boekhandel van de Velde hierachter. Zij zijn blijven aanwezig om uw boeken te signeren. En tot slot wil ik iedereen nogmaals heel erg op het hart drukken om uw telefoon uit te zetten. Dan, I will switch to English, because the main speaker of today is Susan Nijman, and we are very honored and very pleased that you are here today to deliver the 40th Van der Leeuw Lecture, a very special edition. Susan Nijman is the director of the Einstein Forum in Potsdam. And this Einstein Forum is described as an open laboratory for the mind. And it brings together original thinkers from all over the world to test new ideas and to interrogate conventional ones. So I think this is very much equal to what the Van der Leeuw lecture is trying to do. Ms. Nijman was born in Atlanta, in Georgia, and she studied philosophy at Harvard and the Freie Universität in Berlin. She was professor of philosophy at Yale and at Tel Aviv University. Her books are translated into many languages, and they include Slow Fire, Jewish Notes from Berlin, Evil in Modern Thought, Moral Clarity, A Guide for Grown-Up Idealists, and one of my personal favorites, Why Grow Up? Subversive Thoughts for an Infantile Age. In 2019, she published Learning from the Germans, Race and Memory of Evil, in which she explores what other nations can learn from the Germans about confronting the evils of the past. She urges to consider the nuanced forms that evil can assume so that we can recognize and avoid them in the future. Next spring, she will publish another highly thought-provoking book entitled Why Left is Not Woke. And indeed, this is also the title of this lecture. She will give us a taste of this book during this 40th Van der Leeuw lecture. a warm applause for Susan Nyman. Thank you.
Thank you, Ava. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here after the list of many distinguished authors, most of whom I've read and some of whom, a couple of whom are even friends of mine. So it's a fine company you've put me in, and I'm very glad to be here. I'm glad that you said I'm only going to give a taste of the book, because that's true. Something that's a little concerning to discuss such a provocative and easily misunderstood subject in, 45 minutes exactly, I was told. And unfortunately, there won't be a time for discussion or questions, and I suppose questions with this large an audience is a little difficult to pull off. So I can only say the whole book will be out. It's not too long. It should be the sort of thing that you can read certainly in a weekend, and maybe on a long Sunday. I'm trying to write shorter books now. It'll be published by Lebniscott in the spring. And if you have any questions, you're welcome to find me and ask me after the lectures and discussions, because I know how easily it is to misunderstand questions about this subject. Now, I have been told not to deviate an inch from my script, or the subtitles won't work. I will do my best to do this without sounding like a robot. It's not easy. I've also been asked to talk slowly because, although there are subtitles, I realize, of course, that not everybody can follow fast English. If you find me talking too quickly, please just wave and I'll understand. I want to start by saying what this talk is not: a call for bipartisanship or a screed against cancel culture. Nor will I speak of the liberal virtue of working to understand those who do not share your views, although I do think it's a virtue. But I don't consider myself a liberal, perhaps because I live in a place where liberal just means libertarian, and a variety of left-wing positions is always on offer. My own allegiances have always been partisan. I was raised in Georgia during the civil rights movement and turned left from there. At a time when even liberal can be a slur in American culture, it's easy to forget that socialist was once a perfectly respectable political position even there. I'm still happy to be called a leftist and a socialist. What distinguishes the left from the liberal is the view that, along with political rights that guarantee freedoms to speak, worship, travel, and vote as we choose, we also have claims to social rights, which undergird the real exercise of political rights. Social and economic rights to fair labor practices, education, healthcare, housing, and participation in cultural life are codified in the United Nations 1948 Universal Declaration of Human Rights. While most member states ratified it, no state has yet created a society which assures those rights, and the Declaration has no legal force. In 530 languages, it is the world's most translated document, but the Declaration remains aspirational. To stand on the left is to insist that those aspirations are not utopian. Still, I won't discuss the view that the left should pay more attention to economic than to other inequalities. I think this is true, but that position has been argued elsewhere. What concerns me most here are the ways in which contemporary voices considered to be leftist have abandoned the philosophical ideas that are central to any left-wing standpoint, namely, a commitment to universalism over tribalism, a distinction between justice and power, and a belief in the possibility of progress. All these ideas are connected, but for reasons of time, I will only discuss the first today. Except as occasional targets, they are hard to find in contemporary discourse. This has led quite a few of my friends in several countries to conclude morosely that they no longer belong to the left. Despite lifetimes of commitment to social justice, they're estranged by developments in what's called the woke left or the far left or the radical left. I am unwilling to cede the word left or accept the binary suggestion that those who aren't woke must be reactionary. Instead, I'll examine how today's self-identified left have abandoned core ideas any leftist should hold. The right may be more dangerous, but today's left has deprived itself of ideas we need if we hope to resist the lurch to the right. In a few short years, woke was transformed from a term of praise to a term of abuse, often by those who would prefer to return to a world where straight white men call out the shots, which makes me slightly uneasy about using it. Yet the fact that people like Republican Governor Ron DeSantis, or Rishi Sunak, or Eric Zemmour spit out the word woke with scorn should not prevent us from examining it. Can woke be defined? It begins with concern for marginalized persons and ends by reducing each to the prism of her marginalization. The idea of intersectionality might have emphasized the ways in which all of us have more than one identity. Instead, it led to focus on those parts of identities which are most marginalized and multiplies them into forests of trauma. Woke emphasizes the ways in which particular groups have been denied justice and seeks to rectify and repair the damage. In the focus on inequalities of power, the concept of justice is often left by the wayside. Woke demands that nations and peoples face up to their criminal histories. In the process, it often concludes that all history is criminal. What's confusing about the woke movement is that it's fueled by all the emotions traditional to the left. Empathy for the marginalized, indignation at the plight of the oppressed, determination that historical wrongs can be righted. Those emotions, however, are derailed by a range of theoretical assumptions that ultimately undermine them. Which do you find more essential, the accidents we are born with or the principles we consider and uphold? Traditionally, it was the right that focused on the first, the left that emphasized the second. That tradition has been turned around. The concept of universalism once defined the left. International solidarity was its watchword. This was just what distinguished it from the right, which recognized no deep connections and few real obligations to anyone outside its own circle. The left demanded that the circle encompass the globe. That was what standing left meant. To care about striking coal miners in Wales, or Republican volunteers in Spain, or freedom fighters in South Africa, whether you came from their tribes or not. What united was not blood, but conviction. First and foremost, the conviction that behind all the differences of time and space which separate us, human beings are deeply connected in a wealth of ways. To say that histories and geographies affect us is trivial. To say that they determine us is false. Now, it's clear that shared experiences and histories create particular bonds. We all tend to trust those whose codes we needn't work to crack, whose jokes we get in an instant, whose illusions we recognize immediately. It takes an act of abstraction to become a universalist. Learning languages and immersing yourself in other cultures will make that abstraction concrete. You'll never have the same relationship to a culture as do those who fell asleep to its lullabies. But good literature, film, and art can work wonders. The opposite of universalism is often called identitarianism. But the word is misleading, for it suggests that our identities can be reduced to two dimensions at most. In fact, all of us have many whose importance will vary in space and in time throughout our lives. As the philosopher Kwame Anthony Appiah reminds us, quote, until the middle of the 20th century, no one who was asked about a person's identity would have mentioned race, sex, class, nationality, region, or religion, end quote. We're all someone's children, a fact that recedes in importance if we are busy raising our own, but you need only step into your parents' home to shift back to the moment when your primary identity was child. It shifts again when you leave your lover in the morning to take up a professional role at work. Is one of these identities more essential to you than the other? Always? Those shifts of identity are universal, but there are many more. A politically engaged person cannot think of herself as indifferent to politics. Not everyone identifies with whatever they do to make a living, but for those of us who do, imagining ourselves as ourselves in an entirely different profession is to imagine a rudderless void. Depending on the person, those components of identity are at least as important as the two that identity politics insists we consider, ethnic and gender identity. A moment's reflection shows even those to be less determinate than supposed. The life of a black person is dramatically different in America and Nigeria, as Chimamanda Achebe so brilliantly showed in Americana. Being a Jew in Berlin and a Jew in Brooklyn are experienced so differently that I can assure you they amount to different identities. Is there an Indian identity that holds equally for Brahmins and Dalits? Can you identify someone as gay without mentioning whether he lives in Tehran or Toledo? Those who condemned essentializing not two decades past are now content to whittle all the elements of our identity down to two. Even those who know that race is a social construct persist in giving those categories more power than they deserve. Indeed, the more the consensus grows that racial categories have no place in science, the more tenaciously they play a role in political culture. The reduction of the multiple identities we all possess to race and gender isn't a question of appearances. The focus on two dimensions of human experience is a focus on those dimensions which experienced the most generalizable trauma. This embodies a major shift that began in the mid-20th century. The subject of history was no longer the hero, but the victim. The impulse to shift our focus to the victims of history began as an act of justice. History had been the story of the victors, while the victims' voices went unheard. To turn the tables and insist that the victims' stories enter the narrative was just part of righting old wrongs. If victims' stories have claims on our attention, they have claims on our sympathies and systems of justice. So the movement to recognize the victims of slaughter and slavery began with the best of intentions. It recognized that might and right often fail to coincide, that very bad things happen to all sorts of people, and that even when we cannot change that, we're bound to record it. As an alternative to preceding millennia, when the survivor of a massacre by Roman legions or Mongol invaders could expect no more than a laconic shit happens, this was a step towards progress. Yet something went wrong when we rewrote the place of the victim. The impulse that began in generosity turned downright perverse. The limiting case of this trend is the story of Benjamin Wilkomirski, the Swiss man whose claims to have spent his childhood in a concentration camp turned out to be invented. Wilkomirski was not alone. Orchestrated victimhood is perfidious because it mocks the victims of real racist attacks, which occur daily. But I'm less interested now in the consequences than in the fact that they're possible at all. What was recently a stigma has become a source of standing. Where painful origins and persecution were once acknowledged, as in the narratives of abolitionist Frederick Douglass, the pain was a prelude to overcoming it, prevailing over victimhood, as Douglas did, could be a source of pride. Victimhood itself was not. It's a sign of moral progress that we no longer dismiss victim stories as we did for so long. They deserve our sympathy and, wherever possible, reparations. My question is rather what we mean when we call for recognition. The great Austrian Jewish philosopher Jeanne Marie, who survived 2 years at Auschwitz, did not even want to erect a monument to the victims of the Third Reich because, as he wrote, to be a victim alone is not an honor. That claim sprang from an assumption that now seems old-fashioned. Monuments should be reserved for those whose deeds we admire, whose paths we want to follow. Amory wrote admiringly of Frantz Fanon, whose book Black Skin, White Masks proclaims, quote, Fanon, I am not the slave of the slavery that dehumanized my ancestors. Curious what this looks like. Okay. You're all staring so intently. I'd prefer we return to a model in which your claims to authority are focused on what you've done to the world, not what the world did to you. This wouldn't return the victims to the ash heap of history. It allows us to honor caring for victims as a virtue without suggesting that being a victim is one as well. Brian Stevenson, defending convicted murderers facing execution, argues that everyone is more than the worst thing they ever did. Do we want to be reduced to the worst thing that ever happened to us? Identity politics not only contract the multiple components of our identities to one, they essentialize that component over which we have the least control. And the words identity politics have turned toxic, taken up by conservative politicians who refuse to recognize that they're in fact practicing identity politics of their own. I prefer the word tribalism, which beckons barbarity, despite the critique of a well-meaning colleague who expressed concern that the word might be offensive to Native Americans. But the idea wasn't invented in North America. It's as old as the Hebrew Bible. The Bible warns us, again and again, what happens when people unite around tribal identities. Envy, strife, and war are the usual consequences. Tribalism is a description of the civil breakdown that occurs when people, of whatever kind, see the fundamental human difference as that between our kind and everyone else. So what's universal to humanity that's not a sanctimonious lie? Start with pain. Even a world saturated with violent images, you shudder for a moment when you face a photo of a bomb-torn body. Though it's beamed from a foreign country, it could have been your own. You do not make a complicated inference from your own pain to another's. The empathy is instant, though it's usually fleeting. It's an instance of the compassion that Jean-Jacques Rousseau argued is prior to reason and found in everyone. And speaking of bodies, they're composed of many parts. Flesh comes in a dizzying array of shapes and colors and sizes, just as cultures and history do. And it's as interesting as cultures and histories are. But the bones are the framework that holds bodies together. Being a universalist allows you to find fascination and joy in all the ways that people differ, and still come back, time and again, to the bones that build and bind us. What other common human dispositions can we find across times and places? Let's consider another Rousseau thought was basic. We are born free and inclined to resist attempts to restrict our freedom, as recent protests from Hong Kong to Belarus suggest. Moreover, we view it as natural that anyone should resist such attempts. The declaration, we too are human beings, wrote Jean-Paul Sartre, is at the bottom of every revolution. Every argument against slavery, colonialism, racism, or sexism is embodied in the question, is she not a human being? The Ghanaian political philosopher Atu Seki Otu says the question is as much at home in his native Akan as it is in Thomas Jefferson's English. Sekiyotu thinks it's insulting to suggest the idea of the human had to be imported from Europe. And I quote from his book, Left Universalism, "Give Europe credit for giving formal and institutional expression to the common intuitions and dreams of humanity, but do not award the West exclusive property rights." End quote. Universalism is under fire on the left because it's conflated with fake universalism, the attempt to impose certain cultures on others in the name of an abstract humanity that turns out to reflect just a dominant culture's time, place, and interests. That happens daily in the name of corporate globalism. But let's consider what a feat it was to make that original abstraction to humanity. Earlier assumptions were inherently particular, as early ideas of law were religious, down to the tiny Greek states whose goddesses provided refuge to people who were hounded by the goddesses of the city-state next door. Most religious laws had some provision for members of a different religion, albeit most often honored in the breach. But the idea that one law should apply to Protestants and Catholics, Jews and Muslims, lords and peasants, simply in virtue of their common humanity, is a relatively recent achievement, which now shapes our assumptions so thoroughly we fail to recognize it as an achievement at all. We should honor that feat of abstraction, even by those Enlightenment thinkers who were unable to scale the towering achievement they'd wrought and got stuck on the rungs of local prejudice. Let's also consider the opposite. Views like those of the Nazi legal theorist Carl Schmitt, who wrote that anyone who says the word humanity wants to deceive you. Like many of his claims, this one was not original. He was echoing the right-wing thinker Joseph de Maistre, who wrote in 1797, and I quote, "Now there is no such thing as man in this world. In my life, I've seen Frenchmen, Italians, Russians, and so on. I even know, thanks to Montesquieu, that one can be Persian. But as for man, I declare I've never encountered him." Schmitt is considerably more complicated, but rather more appalling. For Schmitt, not even all members of Homo sapiens are considered human. Indeed, Schmitt suggests that universalist concepts like humanity are Jewish inventions meant to disguise particular Jewish interests seeking power in a non-Jewish society. The argument is ominously close to the contemporary argument that Enlightenment universalism disguises particular European interests seeking power in an increasingly non-white world. Neither of these two counter-Enlightenment critics, Schmitt and de Maistre, recognize that human is not an empirical concept, the sort of thing like dog or even Frenchman that you can pick out after a moment or two of examining them. Rather than echoing Schmitt's famous quote, you might say, whoever says humanity is making a normative claim. To recognize someone as human is to acknowledge a dignity in them that should be honored. It also implies that this recognition is an achievement. To see humanity in all the weird and beautiful ways it appears is a feat that demands you go beyond experience. Hannah Arendt thought that Adolf Eichmann should have been tried for crimes against humanity, not for crimes against the Jewish people. It's a distinction that seemed trivial at the time, but its importance is increasingly clear. My support for Black Lives Matter springs neither from tribal membership nor from guilt about wrongs committed by my ancestors, who were impoverished Eastern European Jews who immigrated to Chicago in the early 20th century. I support Black Lives Matter because the killing of unarmed people is a crime against humanity. At the same time, I reject the white counter-movement whose members shout, "All lives matter," because it uses a banal general truth to distract attention from an important empirical truth, namely that African Americans are more likely to be subject to violence than other Americans. It's an empirical fact, but you need a concept of truth to see it. I am going to deviate a moment from my prepared talk with apologies to the translator because of a whole little Twitter storm that I just saw yesterday, and I've no idea where it comes from because this paper has not yet been published, but it may have come from an interview that I gave. Just to be very clear, I do support Black Lives Matter. I have a different argument for it, but I do support it. In a publication called Monde Afrique, that's all over Twitter, it claims I don't support it. I support Black Lives Matter because I'm a universalist in the same way that Hannah Arendt was a universalist. Back to the prepared talk. Yet despite the universalist character of the 2020 movement, which it was initially, a racist right was quick to dismiss it as a case of identity politics. Perhaps the very breadth and diversity of those demanding an end to violence against Black people made them nervous. In June 2020, 77% of all Americans agreed that systemic racism is a major problem. Alas, it wasn't only the right that moved towards tribal rhetoric. By the fall of that year, few voices speaking in defense of Black Lives Matter were universalist. Some explicitly rejected the idea that it was a movement on behalf of commonalities, though it allowed that white allies could play a role. But I'm not an ally. Convictions play a minor role in alliances, which is why they are usually quite short. If my self-interest happens to align with yours for a moment, we could form an alliance. The United States and the Soviet Union were allies until the Nazi regime was defeated. When the US decided its interest lay in recruiting former Nazis to defeat communism, the Soviet Union turned from ally to enemy. To divide members of a movement into allies and others undermines the bases of deep solidarity and destroys what standing left means. It's now an article of faith that universalism, like other Enlightenment ideas, is a sham that was invented to disguise Eurocentric views that supported colonialism. When I first heard such claims some 15 years ago, I thought they were so flimsy they'd soon disappear. For the claims are not simply ungrounded, they turn the Enlightenment upside down. Enlightenment thinkers invented the critique of Eurocentrism and were the first to attack colonialism on the basis of universalist ideas. My ability to predict intellectual trends turned out to be limited. In the last few years, the Enlightenment has been held responsible for most of our misery, just as a century ago, the source for contemporary suffering was called modernity. Enlightenment bashing may have begun in American universities, but its reach has swept through the culture in much of the Western world. One of many examples, Germany normally pours millions into national celebrations of its cultural treasures. In the last two decades, we've had an Einstein Jahr, a Luther Jahr, Luther's virulent anti-Semitism notwithstanding, a Beethoven Jahr, a Marx Jahr. The consensus against Enlightenment is now so broad that as of this writing, there are no similar plans to devote a national year to the 300th birthday of Immanuel Kant. Some of the criticisms voiced today could have strengthened Enlightenment by showing that, through the restless self-critique it invented, it had the power to right most of its own wrongs. Instead, those who might have realized the Enlightenment have been engaged in attacking it. They forget that the Enlightenment emerged from a blasted landscape on a continent soaked in blood. Those who dismiss Enlightenment thinkers as naive or optimistic not only ignore their writings, most importantly, they ignore the history which formed the background to their thought. It was a history of waves of plague without cure and ever-returning religious wars in which countless people died. Women were regularly burned alive as suspected witches, men thrown chained into dungeons for writing a pamphlet. From across the Atlantic came news of barbarities visited on the peoples of the New World. Small wonder that no era in history wrote more or more passionately about the problem of evil. Into this landscape, the Enlightenment introduced the very idea of humanity that its critics were unable to realize. Enlightenment thinkers insisted that everyone, whether Christian or Confucian, Parisian or Persian, is endowed with innate dignity that demands respect. Versions of that idea can be found in Jewish, Christian, and Muslim texts that claim that at least some of us were made in God's image, but the Enlightenment based it on reason, not revelation. From the idea that all people, wherever they come from, have a claim to human dignity, it hardly follows that differences between people do not matter. Individual histories and cultures put flesh on the bones of abstract humanity. What does follow is a notion of human rights that should be guaranteed to everyone, regardless of the history they've lived or the culture they inhabit. There are few charges more bewildering than the claim that the Enlightenment was Eurocentric. Perhaps those who make it confuse 18th century realities with the Enlightenment thinkers who fought to change them, often at considerable personal risk. When contemporary post-colonial theorists rightly insist that we learn to view the world from the perspective of non-Europeans, they're echoing a tradition that goes back to Montesquieu, who used fictional Persians to criticize European mores in ways he could not safely have done as a Frenchman writing in his own voice. Montesquieu's Persian letters were followed by scores of other writings using the same device. La Hontan's dialogue with a Huron and Diderot's supplement to Bougainville's voyage criticized the patriarchal sexual laws of Europe, which criminalized women who bore children out of wedlock, from the perspective of the more egalitarian Hurons and Tahitians. Voltaire's sharpest attacks on Christianity were written in the voices of a Chinese emperor and an indigenous South American priest. Today, Christian Wolff's name is known only to scholars, but in the early 18th century, he was the most famous philosopher in Germany and a major influence on the young Immanuel Kant. Yet in 1723, he was given 48 hours' notice to vacate his professorship at Halle and the territory of Prussia or face execution. His crime? Wolff publicly argued that the Chinese were perfectly moral even without Christianity. His experience was no exception. Nearly all the canonical Enlightenment texts were banned, burned, or published anonymously. 70 years later, when the elderly Immanuel Kant was already known as Germany's greatest philosopher, he was ordered to stop writing or speaking publicly about any question of religion. The Prussian professor obeyed the order until the minister who had issued it was replaced. Let me address the claim that the Enlightenment was the ideology of colonialism because it's important to understand how something so false could come to seem so true. Let's start with the fact that empires were not invented in modern Europe. Stronger nations have colonized weaker ones since the beginning of recorded history, before there were nations in our sense at all. Greeks and Romans built empires, as did the Chinese, the Assyrians, the Aztecs, the Malians, the Khmer, and the Mughals. Those empires operated with varying degrees of brutality and repression, but all of them were based on an equation of might and right, which amounts to no concept of right at all. All of them used their power to compel weaker groups to surrender resources, submit tribute, press soldiers into service for further imperial wars, and accept commands that overrode local custom and law. As far as we know, there was one thing they lacked, a guilty conscience. The 16th century Dominican friar Bartolomeo de las Casas was an early exception. His short account of the destruction of the Indies denounced the atrocities which the Spanish conquest visited on indigenous peoples. But Las Casas argued for a kinder, gentler form of imperialism, which included substituting African for South American slave labor. He never questioned the imperial project as a whole. The Enlightenment did. I'm going to read you Kant's stinging attack on colonialism. Compare the inhospitable actions of the civilized and especially of the commercial states of our part of the world, the injustice which they show to lands and peoples they visit, which is equivalent to conquering them, is carried by them to terrifying lengths. America, the lands inhabited by the Negro, the Spice Islands, the Cape, etc., were at the time of their discovery considered by these civilized intruders as lands without owners, for they counted the inhabitants as nothing. They oppress the natives, excite widespread wars among the various states, spread famine, rebellion, perfidy, and the whole litany of evils which afflict mankind. China and Japan, who've had experience with such guests, have wisely refused them entry. End quote, Immanuel Kant. Though he was hardly a graceful writer, Kant was usually careful with words. He rarely used the word evil. Yet here he's crystal clear. Colonialism creates every kind of evil which affects humankind. Diderot went even further, arguing that indigenous peoples threatened by European colonizers would have reason, justice, and humanity on their side if they simply killed the invaders like the wild beasts the invaders resembled. The Hottentots, he urged, should not be fooled by the false promises of the Dutch East India Company, which had recently founded Cape Town. Quote Diderot, "Fly, Hottentots, fly. Take up your axes, bend your bows, and send a shower of poisoned darts against these strangers. May there not be one of them remaining to convey to his country the news of their disaster." End quote. If you updated the weaponry, you'd be forgiven for thinking you'd come upon a passage of Franz Fanon. The Enlightenment critics of empire didn't simply point out its cruelty. They also deconstructed the theories which sought to justify the theft of indigenous lands and resources. The most important of those theories was John Locke's labor theory of value, which was used to argue that nomadic peoples had no claim to the lands on which they hunted and gathered. Kant disagreed, thereby providing an argument against settler colonialism. If the best of Enlightenment thinkers denounced the vast theft of lands which made up European empires, what did they make of the vast theft of peoples? Most were unequivocal in condemning slavery, along with European complicity in maintaining it. Voltaire's Candide portrays an African in Suriname whose leg was cut off after his attempt to escape from slavery. "That's the price of your eating sugar in Europe," says the enslaved man. Diderot, going further, thought the enslavers would not be moved by pity or moral reasoning and concluded that enslaved Africans must liberate themselves by violence. His prediction that what he called a great man, a black Spartacus, would eventually arise to lead this liberation inspired Toussaint Louverture in Haiti. Like progressive intellectuals everywhere, radical Enlightenment thinkers were only partially successful. While they changed the thinking of their contemporaries on many questions, they did not succeed in stopping the great European rush for empire that gathered full force in the 19th century. Yet if they didn't stop colonialism, they succeeded in giving it a bad conscience. The Romans felt no need to justify their empire, nor tell their subjects that being colonized was good for them. In addition to better ships and weapons, the 19th century colonizers had something earlier imperialists lacked, a need for legitimacy. This sadly must be the source of the legend the Enlightenment sanctioned colonialism. Enlightenment thinkers blasted colonialism and argued that justice was on the side of those non-Europeans who killed or closed their doors to would-be invaders. A half century later, when faced with a powerful critique in the name of ideals they wanted for themselves, European imperialists sought ways to uphold ideals of liberty and self-determination at home while continuing to violate them abroad. Their solution was to claim they were bringing those ideals to those unable to realize them on their own. Rousseau and Diderot and Kant would have seen through the scam and wept to watch their own ideals turned into ideology. But the plunder was tempting, and its critics were dead. It's not accidental that most of those who would have called themselves leftists a generation ago now call themselves progressives. For there's no deeper difference between left and right than the idea that progress is possible. It wasn't an idea found in traditional conservative thought, which viewed history, at best, as static or circular, and at worst, a sad, slow decline from a mythic golden age. On this view, limited improvement may be achievable, but a truly better world could only be found in the afterlife. To stand on the left is to stand behind the idea that people can work together to make significant improvements in the real conditions of their own and others' lives. It's an idea that's often caricatured as the idea that progress is inevitable. Many passages of Hegel and Marx make that claim, and history has not exactly confirmed it. But to deny that progress is assured is not to deny that it's possible. Give up the prospect of progress, and politics becomes nothing but a struggle for power. Most woke activists reject universalism, but they're unlikely to deny they seek progress. But they fail to see that without universalism, there is no argument against racism, merely a bunch of tribes jockeying for power. And if that's what political history comes to, there's no way to maintain a robust idea of justice. But without commitments to universal justice, we cannot coherently strive for progress. I've argued that the ideas which created new realities were born in the Enlightenment. The world changes whenever certain ideas are established as norms. To deny the reality of progress is to deny reality. For the next generation, progress must mean going further to extinguish subtler forms of injustice. That's how progress works. And anger over the slow speed of progress is probably necessary to keep us fighting for it. Yet looking down occasionally at the shoulders we stand on is a way of gathering strength. For if we fail to acknowledge that real progress has been made in the past, we will never sustain the hope of making more in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan Nyman, for this wonderful, thought-provoking, and very diverse lecture. I'm very much looking forward to the responses of our two co-lecturers, who will give their views on this theme after the break. Thank you for all the work you've put into this lecture, and I think most of us are looking forward to reading the book, which will be published in the spring. I think it might be very useful to read it again because there were so many ideas and so many thoughts that you presented. It might be very wise to read them.
Only a little bit.
Only a little. Well, to explore them even more. So thank you so much for this lecture. And I will invite everyone to share your thoughts on this lecture during a cup of coffee in our break. And I hope to see you back in 30 minutes for the next part of our lecture. Welkom terug allemaal. U hoorde net twee studenten van het Prins Klaus Conservatorium. Op saxofoon, Zala Roes. Dankjewel. En op gitaar, Saraswati Gitaar. Dankjewel. En zij speelden, voor degene die het niet herkende, Beatrice van Sam Rivers en Blue Bossa van Kenny Dorham. Dank jullie. Dan door met deel 2 van deze 40e editie van de Van der Leeuw lezing. En omdat het een jubileumeditie is, dachten wij, we gaan gewoon 2 co-referenten vragen. Het is tenslotte een feest. En onze eerste co-referent is Johan Frets, schrijver, theatermaker, columnist van het Parool, onder vele anderen. Hij debuteerde 10 jaar geleden, inmiddels al, in 2012, met de roman Frets 2025, die genomineerd werd voor de Bronzen Uil. En met zijn tweede roman, Onder de Paramariboom, won hij de Boekhandelsprijs 2019. En hij toerde daarna door het hele land met de voorstelling De Zachtmoedige Radicaal, waarmee hij genomineerd werd voor de Cabaretprijs Nederlands Hoop. Inmiddels is hij uitgegroeid dankzij zijn vele columns, opiniestukken, zowel online als offline, tot de stem van een generatie. Afgelopen september maakte hij de documentaire What's Left, die ik u allemaal zeer kan aanbevelen, die hij maakte samen met Jules Optenkamp over de teleurgang van de sociaaldemocratie in Nederland. Een vrij ontluisterend, onthutsend beeld. En 2 weken geleden verscheen bij Lebowski Publishers zijn boek Met Vriendelijke Groet. Een bundel met zijn persoonlijke notities over grote thema's. Een selectie van de stukken die hij sinds 2012 heeft geschreven voor onder meer de Volkskrant, het Parool en One World. Ik wil het woord van harte geven aan Johan Frets.
Dank u wel. Goedemiddag is het nog, denk ik. Avond al. Ik ben net 4 maanden geleden vader geworden van mijn tweede, dus voor mij is tijd sowieso een heel relatief begrip. Dat is tevens de reden dat ik deze week mijn lezing of mijn co-referaat heb geschreven. En niet de vertaling in het Engels op tijd af heb kunnen krijgen. So I want to start in English by thanking you a lot. It's an honor to be on this stage and to be able to reflect on the same themes, Susan, that you put in this great speech you gave for us. And it gave me a lot of stuff to think about, because sometimes I think, oh yeah, that's where I think, oh no, that's I think different. And that's the duality of it. While there are things where I'm strongly, firmly thinking in another direction, but also things that we share, is something really wonderful. And also the reason why, despite the fact that I am one of those voices who says that the use of the word woke has become such an insult that reproducing it every time, even in a great audience, gives a narrative, zuurstof, oxygen, that's sometimes you can think, is it good to stand here when that word is used again? But because I believe in this exchange of ideas, as a liberal maybe, you would say, a left wing, as a left. Now I go into Dutch, but I wanted to say that in English. Nog voor wij hier samenkwamen in, naar ik meen, de oudste kerk van Groningen, nog voor we op onze stoelen gingen zitten en het verwachtingsvolle geroezemoes uitstierf, nog voor het eerste woord van de eerste spreker was uitgesproken, zaten er al bepaalde ideeën in onze hoofden verankerd. Ideeën die daar niet zo makkelijk in kunnen worden uitgedaagd. En dat komt natuurlijk door die twee woorden, ik zei het net al even in het Engels, in de titel van de hoofdlezing. Left en woke. Left. Links. Wat dat betekent, daar hebben we allemaal zo onze eigen ideeën over. Allemaal heel uitgesproken eigen ideeën, want dat kan ook moeilijk anders. Geen ideologisch kamp is meer verdeeld dan de left. We hebben geen grip op de tijd, lijkt het. En we voelen voortdurend dat de grond onder onze voeten en idealen begint te verschuiven. Al is het beven van de grond onder ons in een stad als deze wellicht niet de meest fijne metafoor. Maar toch, het is vooral dat andere woord. Het is dat woord dat ooit een strijdkreet was die geboren werd in de steden van Amerika in de tijd van de segregatie. Stay woke, brother. Stay woke. Open je ogen voor de onderdrukking die ons, de zwarte Amerikanen, tot minderwaardige mensen verklaart. Die onze gelijkwaardigheid gewelddadig aanvalt. En die ervoor zorgt dat wij en onze kinderen, en als we pech hebben, ook hun kinderen, leven in fundamentele onvrijheid. Kom op, sluit je ogen niet langer. Stay woke. Woke, dat een wedergeboorte beleefde toen een volgende jonge generatie recent van burgerrechtenactivisten en normbevragers het afstofte en opnieuw begon te gebruiken. Ook tegen iedereen die dacht dat onze ogen toch al lang waren geopend. Dat we toch echt al heel lang wakker waren. Dat de dream en de hoop en de rise al lang waren volbracht. Een overtuiging die je misschien het best kon horen doorklinken in de meer zoete, maar toch ook ontroerende strofen die je soms voorbij zag komen op social media. Rosa said, so Martin could walk. Martin marched, so Barack could run. And Barack ran, so that our children can fly. Stay woke. Nee, het is nog niet volbracht, zeiden de moedige stemmen van een nieuwe generatie. En het woord woke, dat begon te resoneren, dat vond zijn weg. Verspreidde zich razendsnel over de wereld, langs oceanen, continenten. En zoals dat gaat, onderweg vervormt iets van klank. Werd het overgenomen door juist de hoeders van de status quo. Die de strijdkreet ombogen tot een duivelse religie. De bron van alle kwaad, van de verstikking en de onvrijheid. Van de polarisatie en de censuur. En soms ook als de vijand van de kern van het mens zijn. Out of many, we are one. Universalisme. In de lezing van Susan Nijman ging het over de vraag of de woke-beweging wellicht uit goede intenties is geboren, namelijk empathie met de onderdrukte, maar of hij daarin misschien is doorgeslagen. Dat zinnetje viel mij op bij het lezen ook al van de lezing, omdat ik me realiseerde dat in de zin empathie met de onderdrukten de aanname zit dat het perspectief is vanuit degene die empathie moet hebben met degene die onderdrukt is. Terwijl de stroming misschien in dit geval juist voortkomt uit de mensen die die onderdrukking zelf aan de lijve ondervinden en besluiten hun stem te verheffen. Het leidde me ook tot de vraag in hoeverre het zinnig is om altijd in de reactieve rol te zitten. Om te reageren op datgene wat de norm als notie van wat waarachtig is neerzet. En daarom wil ik het over een heel andere boeg gooien. Ik wil jullie meenemen naar de vroege ochtend van 10 november 2019. Ik was toen ook net woke, dat wil zeggen net wakker, want mijn vriendin Zwaan had mij midden in de nacht om 3 uur 's nachts wakker gemaakt en zei: het is begonnen, volgens mij. En ik zei: wat is er begonnen? De veeën, wat dan? 3 uur later liepen we door de gangen van het OLVG West in Amsterdam. De bevalkamers hadden de namen van landen en steden. We passeerden Nieuw-Zeeland, Japan, Brazilië, New York, Bali, Groenland. Wij reisden de halve wereld rond. Tot de dokter de deur opende van Ierland en zei: hierin. Ierland. Prima, dacht ik. Leuke mensen, goed gevoel voor humor, lekker bier. Dat lijkt me nou een prima start van het leven. De weeën werden meteen krachtiger, dus ik ging ervan uit dat onze zoon het daar ook mee eens was. Ik ging naast Zwaan zitten en keek naar de muur met daarop een wandvullende foto van een kudde schapen. 9 lange uren later, waarbij Zwaan over bovenmenselijke natuurkrachten bleek te beschikken, gebeurde het toch nog heel plots en onverwachts. Daar was hij. Hij kroop uit de buik. Ik zou hem opvangen, vergat het. Iemand anders deed het. En hij begon keihard te krijsen. Zijn ogen stonden fel en helder. Hij had haar. Zo ongelooflijk veel haar. En zijn oren waren schoon als pas aangespoelde schelpen. James Isha, de dikke man. Daniel Frets. 1/4 Hongaars, 1/4 Nederlands, 1/4 Surinaams en 1/4 Duits. Al beweert mijn vader altijd dat zijn moeder uit de Elzas kwam en dat dat van oorsprong Frans grondgebied is. En als je op de stamboom terugzoekt, dan komt zijn familie eigenlijk uit Canada of uit Friesland. Hij heeft eigenlijk net zo lang teruggezocht tot elk spoor van zijn Duitse worten is uitgewist. James, onze eigen wereldburger. Een toonbeeld van wat Zadie Smith ooit noemde de dream people. De mensen van de toekomst wier identiteit uit zoveel wortels is opgebouwd dat zij een nieuwe, grenzeloze wereld belichamen. Er is iets waar ik me 3 jaar later nog steeds voor schaam. Dat me nog iets anders opviel toen hij uit de buik kwam. Eigenlijk zelfs nog voor die oren, die ogen. Zijn kleur. Het was exact mijn kleur. Ik nam dat heel bewust waar en vond dat vervelend. Was er zelfs even door uit evenwicht. Misschien zullen sommigen beweren dat die fixatie voortkwam uit de hedendaagse obsessie met identiteitsdenken, maar dat was het niet. Integendeel. Want zijn kleur viel me niet als eerste op omdat ik zoveel belang hechtte aan kleur. Het was precies andersom. Ik had het grootste deel van mijn leven juist heel nadrukkelijk mijn best gedaan geen enkel belang te hechten aan kleur, tot aan het punt dat ik de helft van mijn oorsprong, de zwarte roots, nagenoeg had uitgewist, zoals mijn vader zijn Duitse geschiedenis ontkende. Maar nu James uit die buik van zijn moeder was gekropen en op haar borst werd neergelegd, nu viel die kleur me op en dat had maar 1 reden. Ik keek naar hem en ik zag mezelf. Dit was mijn zoon. En omdat hij zo onmiskenbaar ook voortkwam uit zwarte roots, ook al kwamen die feitelijk maar van 1 van zijn 4 grootouders, wel mijn moeder, een nogal dwingende grootouder, dus het verbaasde niet echt. Maar omdat ik die wortels in hem zag, kon ik ze onmogelijk nog langer ontkennen in mezelf. In zekere zin markeerde zijn geboorte een definitief keerpunt in mijn leven. Het moment waarop ik me realiseerde dat het politieke in feite diep persoonlijk was. En dat politieke vraagstukken kunnen zien langs een lijn van abstractie in zekere zin een voorrecht is. Dat mijn verbeterde pogingen om de stem der redelijkheid en verbinding te zijn in een kleurenblinde, klasseloze samenleving in feite minder nobel was dan ze klonk. Dat je wanneer je in het oog van de meest grove aanvallen op menselijke gelijkwaardigheid, wanneer je dan kiest voor middenpositie, in feite een misplaatste vorm van neutraliteit omarmt, die geen enkel ander doel dient dan het in stand houden van de status quo. Het is, zoals Martin Luther King ooit zei, vrede die geworteld is in menselijke ongelijkwaardigheid is geen goede vrede, geen ware vrede. Het is een weerzinwekkende vrede, een valse vrede. Onder het mom van verbinding en dialoog worden we voortdurend verleid die vorm van vrede in stand te houden, omdat we anders worden neergezet als verdelers of mensen die zich juist opsluiten in hun eigen tribe. En daarom vraagt het heel wat moed om die schroom af te werpen en je ondubbelzinnig, luid en duidelijk uit te spreken tegen die vorm van fundamentele onvrijheid. Ik hield James vast, in Ierland dus. De reis naar hier, naar dit besef, dit scharnierpunt, voer ver terug als je terugkeek via een veel te late reis naar het land van mijn moeder, Suriname, op mijn 30ste pas. En als je nog verder terugkeek naar het begin van die reis, dan was hij misschien wel begonnen met de opkomst van een zwarte senator en presidentskandidaat met de naam Barack Hussein Obama, die er trouwens net als ik ook een sport van had gemaakt zijn eigen otherness te relativeren. En zichzelf in de campagne doelbewust stevast a skinny kid with a funny name noemde. Denken mensen aan de speeches van Barack Obama, dan is het vaak aan de hoop, the change, aan yes we can, and there is not a left-wing America or a right-wing America, there's only the United States of America. Maar de toespraak die mij altijd het meest heeft geraakt is a more perfect union. De meeste van jullie herinneren het zich misschien vaag of beter. Maar Obama was op een gegeven moment in zijn campagne, het waren nog de voorverkiezingen tegen Hillary Clinton, in opspraak gekomen omdat zijn predikant Jeremiah Wright behoorlijk agressieve anti-Amerika taal had uitgeslagen in een opgedoken video. En die uitspraken raakten aan alle raciale stereotypen die in de Verenigde Staten natuurlijk nooit ver onder de oppervlakte raakten. De vraag die Amerika nu bezig hield was of Obama wel de real deal was. Was hij misschien stiekem toch een radical, een angry black man? Werd zijn achtergrond, zijn middelste naam Hussein, nu toch een struikelblok van een historische race? De eerlijkheid gebiedt ons te erkennen dat het nu waarschijnlijk inderdaad einde oefening was geweest van zijn campagne. Iedereen leeft tenslotte in zijn eigen werkelijkheid. Feiten zijn niet langer onwrikbaar. En de meest nauwe tribale tendensen richting fascisme en biologisch racisme zijn inmiddels genormaliseerd en tot de mainstream doorgedrongen. Maar in die tijd, 2008, zaten wij nog vlak voor die periode dat social media zouden verwoorden tot een veelkoppig monster. En ook Obama zou later zeggen dat zijn winst alleen daardoor mogelijk was geweest. Omdat hij, ondanks de vooroordelen, in staat was geweest een genuine connection te maken met witte Amerikanen in Iowa en New Hampshire, die misschien wel wat vooroordelen hadden over zwarte Amerikanen, maar hem open tegemoet traden zonder ruis op de lijn. Obama stond na die Wright-ophef onder hoogspanning. Als deze speech zou mislukken, dan was het game over. Maar het werd zijn beste speech, waarin hij een eerlijke, messcherpe, kwetsbare en daarom zo ijzersterke bespiegeling gaf over Amerika en ras. De passage die mij het meest bijbleef, citeer ik even. Het ging over de vraag of hij die pastoor dan ook moest cancelen eigenlijk, zullen we maar even zeggen in het populaire jargon. I can no more disown him than I can disown the black community. I can no more disown him than I can disown my white grandmother, a woman who helped raise me, a woman who sacrificed again and again for me, a woman who loves me as much as she loves anything in this world, but a woman who once confessed her fear of black men who passed her by on the street, and who on more than one occasion has uttered racial or ethnic stereotypes that make me cringe. These people are part of me. and they are part of America, this country that I love. Ik had tranen in mijn ogen, omdat ik voelde dat zijn verhaal zo nadrukkelijk ook mijn verhaal was. Ook mijn leven, mijn identiteit, zoals je wilt, bestaat uit al die werelden. Omdat Nederlanders New York inruilden voor 1 gulden en een klein tropisch landje vol goud en bauxiet. Omdat mijn Duitse grootouders vluchtten voor Adolf Hitler. En omdat de Nederlandse priester Titus Brandsma ze aan de juiste papieren hielp. Die twee gelukzoekers, daarom ben ik hier. Ik stam af van kolonisten en slaven, van bezetters en bevrijders. En misschien moet ik daarom de hele geschiedenis dankbaar zijn. De goede, maar ook de vrede delen. En het is dat wat ik absoluut wel deel met Susan Neiman. Dat we niet gedefinieerd worden door onze geschiedenis. Dat weet iedereen vanzelfsprekend al die zoveel werelden in zichzelf heeft. Maar jullie allemaal ook. Wij zijn optelsommen van toevalligheden. Routes die door niemand zijn uitgestippeld die elkaar tegenkwamen. Obama werd vaak de bridge genoemd omdat hij zowel een witte als een zwarte ouder had. De bridge. Misschien dacht ik, kon ik dat ook zijn, zo'n verzoener. De speech landde, Obama won en we waren in een collectieve roes. Dit was de belofte van een postraciaal tijdperk. Een tijdperk waarin identiteit op basis van aangeboren kenmerken voorgoed naar de achtergrond zou verdwijnen. Het liep anders. Obama, de eerste zwarte president van Amerika, werd opgevolgd door Donald Trump, een schaamteloze racist. En dat was onmiskenbaar juist een reactie op de verkiezing van Obama zelf. Dat werd misschien het best geduid door de essayist Ta-Nehisi Coates, een zwarte schrijver die Obama altijd veel te verbindend vond en veel te zalvend. Hij schreef dat we lang dachten dat racisten en conservatieve krachten de achtergestelde zwarte als bedreiging zagen. In Nederland hoorde je dat eigenlijk ook een beetje sinds 2002. Die mensen in de wijken die voor criminaliteit zorgen, als ze nou wat beter integreren, meedoen en de taal spreken, dan horen ze er gewoon bij. Maar nu, een paar decennia later, blijkt het juist omgekeerd te zijn. Het is niet de achtergestelde zwarte of allochtoon. Het is juist de man die eloquent en intelligent in het Witte Huis belandt, dat ooit nog door slaven was gebouwd. Dat was juist voor velen angstaanjagend. Je zou kunnen zeggen, juist het afwerpen van het slachtofferschap werd gezien als een gevaar. Wat doet het met mensen wanneer ze ontdekken dat ze gehaat worden niet om wat ze doen en dat die haat niet kan worden afgeworpen door het beter te doen, maar gehaat worden om wie ze zijn? Ik vind het niet raar dat in de jaren hierna een nieuwe wereldwijde golf van antiracisme en antiseksisme, activisme en emancipatiestrijd plaatsvond. De rechteloze, de stemloze, de machteloze, niet uit slachtofferschap, kozen nu juist vanuit unapologeticness voor een radicaal verzet. En radicaal betekent uiteindelijk niets anders dan altijd vertrekkend vanuit de wortels. Radix. Zoals elke beweging kent ook deze stroming van bewonderenswaardig activisme een zeer verstikkend puristisch deel. Een neiging om dogmatiek te bestrijden met nieuwe dogma's. Om nooit meer in aanraking te willen komen met iemand die fundamenteel anders tegen de wereld aankijkt zonder een trigger warning. Of om de felbare mens als een echte schoolpleinbully in naam der rechtvaardigheid af te serveren zonder enig mededogen en ook zonder enige kans om ooit tot vergeving of heling te komen. Ik erger me daar evenzeer kapot aan en ben als bounty, zoals ik ook zo vaak genoemd word, ook heel vaak zelf het mikpunt van dat purisme geweest en nog steeds. Maar dat verstikkende deel voert in mijn optiek juist allerminst de boventoon in de beweging. En het is dan ook extreem pijnlijk om te zien dat de kritiek zich zo vaak en zo generiek richt op al diegenen die eigenlijk niets anders doen dan breken met de tirannie van onvrijheid. Zij hebben juist de moed gevonden zich onbevreesd uit te spreken. Zich niet langer te verhouden tot de normbewakers en poortwachters. Nee, juist vol vreugde en vuur, zoals James Baldwin dat ook zo goed kan, met die grijns op zijn gezicht. You don't own me. Ik ben hier. Zonder zich daar nog voor te verexcuseren. Geïnspireerd door die jonge generatie en door dat vaderschap, die geboorte van mijn zoon, heb ik ook dat vuur in mezelf hervonden. Of gevonden. Waar ik vroeger een brug wilde zijn, stel ik mezelf nu de vraag, waarom moet ik een brug zijn? Een levenloos ding. een stalen constructie tussen twee bestemmingen in. Iets zonder ziel, emotie, binnenwereld, zelf nooit aankomen op een bestemming. En gek genoeg zit er ook iets heel anti-universalistisch in het idee dat mensen van gemengd bloed de verzoeners zijn, omdat het impliceert dat die verschillen er inderdaad zijn. Dat de zwarte en de witte wereld tegenover elkaar staan en dat eigenlijk als een soort hele verdraaide manier van denken degene die dat allebei in zich heeft de boel kan redden. Ik geloof nog steeds in verzoening. In dat wat Martin Luther King noemt de radicale, niet-sentimentele kracht van alles overstijgende liefde. In de kreet van Baldwin dat we uiteindelijk als mensen allemaal broeders en zusters zijn en dat als je dat niet begrijpt, je reddeloos verloren bent. Maar ik ben wel gaan inzien dat de verzoening pas kan bestaan als ook de onverzoenlijkheid ondubbelzinnig wordt benoemd en bestreden. En daarin zul je soms nu toch echt kleur moeten bekennen, zodat het universalisme niet alleen een valse belofte blijft die aan veel mensen nog altijd voorbij gaat, maar een werkelijkheid. Ik begrijp best dat dat soms weerstand oproept. Zeker als je gewend bent juist zelf altijd aan die meest progressieve kant te staan. Maar uiteindelijk is het lot van elke generatie, uiteindelijk ook van mij, dat er een nieuwe jeugd op de poorten rammelt die onze blinde vlekken bevraagt, uitdaagt, die ons irriteert en prikkelt, verward, besmeurd met tomatensoep of lijm, in beweging zet en daarmee een onmisbare schakel is in die nooit voltooide ketting van vooruitgang. De paradox van emancipatie is dat je je groepeert om tegen iets te strijden en je daarmee in zekere zin ook afzondert in een groep, lijkt het. Maar dat doe je niet omdat je daar zo graag zit, dat doe je juist omdat je daar uiteindelijk uit wilt komen. Het is moeilijk voor veel mensen om daarin zo erg te worden gecaricaturiseerd. Bespot. We zijn hier in Groningen. Ik hoef hier denk ik niemand uit te leggen wat het betekent als anderen, in dit geval een heel land, een heel politiek speelveld, denkt te weten wat voor jou het beste is. En hoe je je het best kunt opstellen. Nu vraag ik je, wat betekent het als je tegen mensen die proberen uit het donker te herrijzen zegt dat ze de verlichting niet hebben begrepen? Wat betekent het als je zegt, ik steun je strijd voor gelijkwaardigheid, maar kun je het alsjeblieft een beetje anders doen? Wat betekent het als je zegt dat links, om te herrijzen, de strijd voor emancipatie en menselijke gelijkwaardigheid misschien even moet parkeren omdat het eigenlijk over klassen zou moeten gaan? Of als je zegt, ik weet dat enkele denkers van de verlichting hebben gezegd dat de superioriteit van de mens samenkomt in het witte ras, maar dat waren maar voetnoten. Omarm ze gewoon. Mag het minder luid, minder zichtbaar en liever niet tijdens Verdi's Requiem en liever niet daar en liever niet hier en eigenlijk liever nergens en geen excuses, want het is zo lang geleden en ik hoef me toch niks. Nee, daar gaan we weer. Dan toch nog even die andere quote van Baldwin. You discovered us, now you have us. I've dealt a long time with you, now you have to deal with me. Met andere woorden, stay woke. Maar dan niet in die nauwe, verstikkende zin die ook ik van me afwerp. Maar in de ware zin dus, duaal, zoals ook Susan Neiman op haar manier doet. Ook al zijn we het niet over alles eens. En altijd in beweging, je bevragend, je ogen openhoudend voor nieuwe inzichten. En dat woke, dat is dus geen aanval op gedeelde menselijkheid. Maar gewoon een aanspraak, een oproep om onze plicht om de handschoen op te pakken. Juist ook als links. En ons te realiseren dat alle vormen van ongelijkheid en onvrijheid uiteindelijk met elkaar verweven zijn en altijd samen tegelijk moeten worden bestreden. Weet je, soms denk ik dat wij al 20 jaar vastzitten in een grijs gedraaide plaat. Eerst heette het politieke correctheid, toen kwam de good mens terug in een soort nieuwe renaissance. En nu is het woke, cancel culture, anti-woke, pro-woke. Het begint bij de taal. De beroemde dichter Amanda Gorman zei: "We've learned that quiet isn't always right and that our notion of what just is isn't always justice." Daar dacht ik aan toen ik mijn dochter 2 dagen geleden midden in de nacht vasthield, rechtop, om haar boertje te laten naar de nachtfles. Lea. 4 maanden oud. En wat denk je? Wit. Blond. Helblauwe ogen. Evenzeer zie ik mezelf als ik naar haar kijk. James en Lea, ze komen voort uit dezelfde routes. Ze zien er anders uit, maar zijn mens. Ja, die Obama, die held van mij, had toch gelijk. Out of many, we are one. Universalisme. En Gorman zei the hill we climb, maar volgens mij is het nu tijd om naar een volgende fase te gaan. En ons niet meer bezig te houden met het beklimmen van de heuvel, maar een wereld te schetsen die achter die heuvel ligt. Ik nodig jullie daartoe uit. Het lijkt mij in ieder geval de taak van links om daar vandaag mee te beginnen. We verlaten dat grijsgedraaide narratief, breken met de denkbeeldige botsingen tussen klassenstrijd en emancipatiestrijd. Vormen een breed front met bondgenoten waarin ruimte is voor de wijsheid van de vorige generatie, maar ook voor het vuur van de nieuwe. En we rekenen af met Martin Luther King's weerzinwekkende valse vrede, met die radicale, helende, niet sentimentele, maar waarachtige kracht van liefde. De ultieme vorm van vrijheid. En zo ruilen wij die oude wereld in voor een nieuwe. Dank jullie wel.
Het is maar dat u weet wat ons te doen staat. En ik zou zeggen, daar kunnen we niet snel genoeg mee beginnen. Dank je wel, Johan, voor je indrukwekkende, persoonlijke en lucide verhaal. Echt fantastisch. Dan heeft u zowaar nog een spreker van ons te goed. Een hele bijzondere, opnieuw. De in Polen geboren schrijfster Alicja Kaczynska is een van de meest vooraanstaande filosofen in België. Ze schreven onder andere het meermaals bekroonde boek De Verovering van de Vrijheid, verschillende filosofische essaybundels, de roman Een Soort van Liefde en de indrukwekkende dichtbundel Trojaanse Gedachten. Voor Canvas maakte zij de filosofische televisiereeks Wanderlust, waarin zij filosofische gesprekken voerde met internationale denkers als Roger Scruton, Theodore Dalrymple en Yusuf Nadour. Dit jaar publiceerde zij Denkers van Vandaag voor de Wereld van Morgen, dat ik u zeer kan aanraden. En waarin zij met 12 denkers, waaronder Susan Nyman, spreekt over de staat van de wereld en die van de toekomst. Deze zomer werd Alicja bovendien door koning Philip benoemd door commandeur in de Leopoldsorde. Dus we hebben niet zomaar iemand uitgenodigd. Mag ik het woord geven aan Alicja Kaczynska?
Thank you, Eva, for this wonderful introduction. And thank you everyone who made this 40th Van der Leeuw lecture possible. I'm truly honored and delighted to be standing here. Ik ga ook excuses aanbieden aan jullie allemaal dat ik vandaag in het Engels ga praten. Zoals Eva zei, ben ik in Polen geboren en heb ik op latere leeftijd de Nederlandse taal geleerd. Ik hou van de Nederlandse taal. Ik schrijf erin met heel veel liefde. Maar aangezien Susan Neyman de eregast is, heb ik besloten om mij aan te passen en de lezing in het Engels te doen. Ik hoop dat jullie daar begrip voor hebben. And I want to thank you, Susan Neyman, for your wonderful thought-provoking, brilliant lecture. And also I want to thank you for your very interesting addition to it and your lecture. I hope you will forgive me, but in my talk, I will not delve into the discussion about woke and the left and how they relate to each other for many reasons. One of those reasons is that I am always terribly hesitant to use the term woke because I don't quite know what to make of it. What does that term really refer to? I think it is too often being used in a derogatory manner today. And that obstructs an objective analysis of it. Furthermore, I don't think woke qualifies as a distinct ideology or a specific movement. It has rather become a container concept in which all sorts of sensitivities are being thrown, and then very often, thrown away. In the summer of 2 years ago, I had a rich conversation online with Susan Ehman about the state of the world. Not surprisingly, the conversation went into the direction of discussing current politics. And before we delved into discussing the dangers of populism, Susan Ehman said that she's reluctant to use the term populism because it is so vague and so often being used in a vain and careless manner. And that is almost impossible now to make an objective analysis of today's problems in politics and society by means of that term. And I must admit that I have a similar attitude towards the term woke today. It is too often a too easily applied label, and as it goes with labels in our daily lives, we use them in order to quickly know what's inside a box or a container. They are very handy most of the time. But when used to describe someone or groups of people, they tend to obstruct further analysis, further dialogue and discussion, and as such, they are part of a fundamental problem in today's world: the qualitative decline of the public open debate. Terms like left, right, progressive, conservative are constantly used, not so much as to clarify things, but rather in order to frame a certain thinker, a politician, a movement, or a group of people. Once we have labeled someone, we think we already know in advance what that labeled person thinks and stands for. No further inquiry or questions are necessary. This not only obstructs a real engagement with each other and a real intellectual encounter, it can also be a dangerous thing with devastating consequences. Many times, just being labeled in a specific way suffices to attack and being attacked. To give but one example, the psychiatrist and writer Theodore Dalrymple is often, and indeed not without reason, described as a conservative thinker. There are certain aspects of his worldview and in his concept of man that could be qualified as conservative. However, progressive people very often react utterly negative and even hostile whenever Dalrymple is mentioned. And as such, they discredit many aspects of his thought that are not conservative, or even if they are conservative, are worth pondering about a bit longer. Though I understand our need to make categorizations and how these categorizations help us to make sense of the world, I think the way we label other people in today's intellectual and political debate is counterproductive. It limits our understanding of each other, and all too often, the result is that a public debate becomes a duel rather than a dialogue. And without a proper dialogue, democracy cannot function properly. Therefore, I would like to shift the focus to what Susan Neyman has put quite central in her own talk, namely universalism. I share her concern that this notion of universalism risks being forgotten or risks being discarded altogether. The world has globalized, but our minds have retained a certain element of provincialism. The scope and reach of our feelings of solidarity and collective responsibility tend to be limited to the communities we belong to. And the wider and the more abstract these communities become, from nations to transnational unions, the feebler our feelings of solidarity and collective responsibility. This is an observation that has, of course, been made numerous times before. People tend to be more interested in their local communities, in their local news. Things that happen close to them feel more relevant and important than what happens on the other side of the world. This phenomenon can even be explained biologically and in terms of evolutionary psychology. But it is important to keep in mind that the fact that something can be explained in terms of evolutionary advantages does not imply that something is morally justified. It is easy to imagine just how disastrous the consequences for our world would be if all of us were concerned only with what happens to our immediate relatives and our own communities. Hence, we find ourselves confronted with a crucial question. How do we manage to look beyond our group, our community, our country, our interests? In other words, how can we be concerned with faraway events and circumstances and act upon that concern, even if, and precisely even when, that does not seem immediately beneficial to us? I believe that finding a convincing answer to the above questions is the biggest challenge of our century. It is a crucial question, far more than it has ever been before in history, for the simple reason that we have never been with so many on this planet. Soon we will be with 8 billion people, which means that a group that falls outside what we consider ours is becoming bigger by the day, bigger by the hour. How to include those others? In fact, everyone. When thinking about the future of the world and when talking seriously about solidarity and collective responsibility. I believe we have to go back to our basic common ground. What is it that still binds us when we are stripped of nationality, gender, the group we belong to, religion? What remains is the bare fact of being a human being. How can we turn this bare human being into the solid foundation of our moral concerns, responsibilities, and rights? The latter was the main concern of numerous thinkers in the past that have been identified as humanists. Humanism is a term that has been used to refer to a wide range of events in the history of ideas and the history of the world. The humanism of the Romans, the humanism of the Renaissance, 19th century Weimar humanism, Christian humanism. And today the term is often used to refer to non-religious secular movements that identify as free thinkers. These are all quite distinct phenomena, but the common ground, the core aspect of humanism in its different meanings and manifestation, is always this idea that a human being is sacrosanct and the epicenter of our moral universe. And since every human being is a human being, the reach of our moral obligations is by definition universal. The Roman statesman and philosopher Cicero famously expressed this humanist view in his letters to his younger brother Quintus. Even towards distant peoples and nations, even to people we'd describe as barbarians, you owe it to your humanitas to be concerned about their comforts, their needs, and their safety. End quote. The key word in this quote for me is humanitas. And in what follows, I would like to rediscover this idea of humanitas and advocate a reevaluation of this crucial notion. Humanitas was an important, indeed a vital notion in the Roman era. It was the underlying principle of the virtues and qualities that were deemed essential to being a good person and a good citizen. Humanitas was central to ideas of philanthropia, love of mankind, and paideia, education or learning. You were educated into becoming a good person and a good citizen, which is becoming a more humane human being. That is what humanitas meant, becoming a person who is concerned with the well-being of others, who is not self-centered, who is kind and modest in his intersubjective relations, who is aware of the universal reach of his moral responsibility. Once again, it's about being a more humane human being. Before I continue, I want to add that I'm fully aware that ancient Greek and Roman societies looked completely different from the ones we live in today. But I don't believe we would be making much progress if we threw away everything that the past has to offer because of the bad things of that past. We still need to stand on the shoulders of the giants of the past, even if only to use those shoulders as a springboard to reach greater heights. And one of those springboards is, I believe, precisely this notion of humanitas, even if this notion was developed at a time when many people were not being treated in a humane way. The notion of humanitas has now become largely forgotten, and if we look at the history of the 20th century philosophy, we see that only very few thinkers have revisited the idea of humanitas in their own thought. Two thinkers stand out in this regard, Max Scheler and Hannah Arendt. Both of them advocate the reevaluation and a return to the idea of humanitas, but did so in quite different ways. Scheler put emphasis on the idea of universal benevolence in his conceptualization of humanitas, whereas Arendt put emphasis on the active role we need to adopt in the polis and in the public debate. Of all great philosophers of the 20th century, Max Scheler is the most underestimated one. One of Scheler's most important books is The Nature of Sympathy, in which he explores different aspects of our intersubjective nature, namely our ability to relate to others, to sympathize with others, to feel with others, to love and hate others. Scheler covers pretty much the entire emotional and moral landscape of our interpersonal relations. Scheler argues that our ability to sympathize with others, what we today call our sense of empathy, is closely connected to benevolence, and that these two sympathy and benevolence constitute our humanitas. Cultivating our humanitas, thus, means cultivating our empathic capabilities and our benevolence towards others. Schiller speaks of the emotional realization of the unity of mankind that is achieved in fellow feeling. And he speaks of the crucial moral value of being benevolent towards others, and indeed, to all others. In a quote reminiscent of Cicero's Universal Humanism, Schiller states, and I quote, "A genuine love of humanity does not discriminate between fellow countrymen and foreigners, the virtuous and the criminal, or between good and bad generally. Like fellow feeling, it embraces all men simply because they are men." End quote. In Hannah Arendt's work, the term humanitas appears several times, in particular in her collection of essays, Men in Dark Times. Each of these essays is devoted to thinkers or world leaders who, in the most difficult times, embraced the burden of responsibility and tried to stimulate the humaneness of society they lived in. Arendt wrote that the humanity of man is a compelling necessity, and described this absolute moral must as humanitas. Humanitas is the summum of human dignity, the essence of being a human being. It is the liberation from self-centeredness. It is the widened horizon of our minds. Humanitas is not something we are born with. It is an achievement, something that needs to be developed, cultivated, conquered. And in order to do so, you need to engage with your fellow human beings. You need to enter the public sphere, the polis. And first and foremost, you need to talk with each other. To quote Arendt, "The venture into the public realm in which humanitas is acquired is a gift to mankind." According to Arendt, human beings don't merely exist in the world exists in between human beings. If you retreat from the public realm and from your fellow beings, you make the world smaller, emptier, up to the point that the world can become a desert. Each and every one of us becomes more isolated, more alone, with less understanding between us. The result will always be a loss of humaneness. That's why Arendt was very much concerned with the erosion of the public realm. She felt that, in her time, there was a qualitative decline of the intellectual and political debate. There were too many lies, too many misconceptions about what it means to form a polis, a community, and being a member of it. Today, Arendt's words seem to me even more true than there were in her time. The public realm, the political debate, should result in more clarity, insights, and understanding. But what we have today is an abundance of misinformation, fake news, confusion, information bubbles, and labels, as I have said at the beginning, that are being used to frame people, not to understand them. The result is a fragmentation and a disintegration of the polis, and that implies a loss of humaneness, of humanitas. Of course, it would be simplistic to claim that we just need to return to certain ideas cultivated by our predecessors. Reading Cicero, Schiller, Arendt, and coming to appreciate the different aspects of the idea of humanitas better won't magically cure us from the maladies of our times. Yet, I do believe, and hence this plea, that a revaluation of certain key components of the humanist mindset and worldview, like the idea of humanitas, is of paramount importance. Cultivating our humanitas means always trying to be benevolent to others and empathizing with them in the Schillerian sense of humanitas. And it means being an active citizen in the polis, as Arendt emphasized. The value of Schiller's and Arendt's insights and ideas can be appreciated by people who belong to very different ideological, philosophical, political, and religious families. A plea for revisiting the notion of our universal humanitas is a call to acknowledge and to develop our sense of responsibility to the world. And that is, again, I strongly believe, an ideal that is neither exclusive left-wing or right-wing, progressive or conservative. I would even dare to say that humanitas transcends ideology and should definitely not be considered as one. Though the fact that our sense of solidarity naturally and culturally tends to be limited to our immediate surroundings, the fact that we can transcend the narrow limits of our surrounding as well is part of our shared human nature and can be culturally developed. In that regard, I would like to end with the words of Immanuel Levinas. Levinas spoke of the limitless responsibility towards the other. In his book, The Humanism of the Other, published exactly 50 years ago, he expressed his concern about the anti-humanism of his days, and he deplored the way in which people all too often turn away from each other and from their universal obligation towards each other. That universal, limitless obligation might seem like an enormous burden, but it is in fact, according to Levinas, what constitutes the humaneness of the human being, indeed, our humanitas. Considering all the global challenges we face as mankind, from climate change to worldwide injustices, migration flows, refugee crises, cultivating our humanitas is the most important task we all have in life. Thank you.
Dankjewel, Alicia, voor je prachtige lezing. Ik denk dat de drie verhalen die we gehoord hebben ongelooflijk mooi in elkaar schuiven. Dat we inderdaad niet alleen de heuvel moeten opklimmen waar Johan het over had, verder moeten kijken. Dat doen we door onze humanitas te cultiveren. De liefde waar Johan het al over had, onze menselijkheid, de grenzeloze verantwoordelijkheid voor de ander. Prachtig. Dank jullie wel. Ik kijk even naar mensen met bloemen in hun handen. Willen we die nu geven? Of is dat later? Ja? Ik wil heel graag de sprekers nog even naar voren halen. Ik blijf allemaal nog even zitten. We zijn nog niet helemaal klaar. Susan Nijman, Alicia Kaczynska en Johan Frets, kom nog even naar voren.